Good morning, everybody. How is everyone? All right on. So I am up here with some of the leaders and the forerunners in the experiential technology side. Just want to go down the list and introduce some of the folks that we have here today. We have Brent Bushnell. He's the CEO of 2-Bit Circus, a Los Angeles-based experiential entertainment company. Their interdisciplinary team strives to make entertainment more enriching and learning more fun. Most recently, the team launched Steam Carnival, a modern reimagining of the Midway to inspire kids about science, technology, engineering, art, and math. He's also a supporter of Clowns Without Borders. Tom Carter. He is the CTO and founder of Ultrahaptics, a company that creates technology that lets you feel objects and controls without wearing or touching anything, using ultrasound to project sensations through the air and directly into your hands. Joe Michaels. He's the chief revenue officer of AxonVR, inventors of an advanced haptic technology called HaptX that uses microfluids to let you feel virtual objects with lifelike realism. He's in charge of creating solutions for AxonVR's enterprise customers who are mostly in the fields of entertainment, training, and manufacturing. We have Cliff Plumer. He's had an extensive career in the film industry as the CTO at Lucasfilm and CEO of Digital Domain. He was involved in the early days of Oculus, worked with Samsung on the launch of Gear VR, was the president of Jaunt Studios, and worked with Google on Daydream before joining The Void as CEO. And last but certainly not least, David Edwards. He teaches at Harvard and is the co-founder of Onotes. Among his inventions are inhaled insulin, edible packaging, sounds delicious, and the Atom Screen, a new type of digital display. Onotes, his digital scent platform, involves an app which acts like iTunes for scents and an Onotes player, a Cyrano, a kind of speaker for scents. And I am Tal Blevins, your moderator for today's panel, and I am the head of media for UploadVR. With that in mind, you know, VR is a big part of my world. I just wanted to jump in, you know, we're seeing VR as the most immersive technology we've really had to date. It's super emotional, gets you right into that experience. But it relies really on visuals and audio to create those experiences right now. How are you making sure that, you know, with these experiential technologies that you're trying to develop, how can you create realism that's just as real as the audio side and the visual side that we see in virtual reality right now? And Joe, I actually want to start with you on this one.
Sure. I would say that one of the fundamental aspects of realism in VR is touch. When you think about coming out of the womb and entering the world, one of the first things that you know tells you that the world is real is your sense of touch. And someone pointed out to me yesterday, I thought was very interesting, when you talk about touch, there are four basic modalities of it, four basic flavors. And one of the things that we try to do is bring all of them together to make the touch realistic. So you have tactile pressure, you have vibrotactile feedback, you have thermal sensation, and you have force feedback. And you know, so it's not a simple thing. It's like an equation that you need to build in order to create that tactile realism. And that's what we've spent the last 4 years working on. And I think there are a lot of senses that go into realism, but you can't really do it effectively without touch.
Great. Anything to add? Yeah,
just to add to it, because to your point, it's not just visual and sound. It's touch. It's, in our case, you know, we also have smell. We have wind. There's all those other senses. It's a bit unfortunate. The last few years, VR has been about putting on an HMD and looking around, where obviously our thesis is give the user the freedom to go and explore in a virtual world, which includes touching things, includes you know, not just seeing and hearing, but you know, hitting on all the senses that we can to make you fully immersed in that environment, not just visuals and sound.
When your senses agree with what your eyes are seeing, it completely transforms the experience. And you know, you will forget. You know in your brain you're standing on this stage, but what you're seeing just will, you know, make you completely reimagine the reality.
Well, so that's interesting. So how do we actually get to, like you said, like when all your senses are working together, right? It makes it more realistic, but how do we get to a standard where then all these devices and all these different technologies then are kind of talking to one another and making sure that they are delivering the correct experience? I mean, is that even possible?
There's a standard coming out. Working on that, it's open XR. You know,
I'm not sure we have to be driven by standards just yet because we're still driving so much R&D and experimenting. I think eventually we'll get there. I mean, coming from the film industry, standards happen in generations, not months or years. And we'll get there.
And the one thing I would add is that the game engines have been a nice sort of foundation for all of this, for the development. And I think they have a big role to play, the Unities, the Unreal Engines, and others, to really sort of tie together the various senses. That right now, you don't have properties of scent or haptics, you know, in any meaningful way in the game engines. And that's a place they need to get to.
I mean, like you were saying, I think games and you know are very easy to understand how these technologies might be used. But I mean, Tom, where do you see like other applications for these kinds of new experiential technologies?
I think that enterprise is certainly a very interesting area. If you look today, the number of people, I think as mentioned in the previous panel, that work on three-dimensional content, whether that's you know, CG modeling, CAD design, or even just data that is better represented in three dimensions, but you view it all on a two-dimensional display. So the ability to pull that out into three dimensions so you can actually see it and observe it in three dimensions is fantastic. But there's a whole body of research that shows that if you have a 3D object, if you can actually touch it, feel it, move it, manipulate it, you understand what you're working on a lot better. And so in the enterprise sector there's a good path to, well, if you can visualize your 3D data or your 3D model, touch it and move it, you'll understand it, you'll work faster, you'll get better results, you'll make better decisions. So I think there's going to be a big area in enterprise for adding these extra experiential technologies as well.
We opted to go for enterprise as opposed to consumer markets as we launch our company. And I learned that training and simulation is a huge opportunity for VR and for haptics. I read the other day that that the Department of Defense spends $4 to $7 billion a year on training and simulation in the U.S., which of course was before the current administration, which could only increase it in some ways. So it's almost low hanging fruit because they've been using VR in clever ways. Now they need to bring the other senses into it to make it more realistic. For example, you know you've got the battlefield and training soldiers. You know, but you've also got people who are medics and operating, you know, cockpits and maintaining tanks, and all that stuff requires training and realism and modeling, and it's all something that VR is very well suited to.
And you know, VR experiences will always be the best in out of home because you know it's a synthesis of having the haptics and the scent and all of that. That's going to be hard to put in your living room. You know, you got to sort of reconfigure your living room around that. But to put it in out of home, you really be thoughtful about you know curating that experience.
I think the other point to that is VR has been missing the social aspect that we all want.
Absolutely.
And it's something again we feel strongly that. You know, people need to go through together. I mean, you share experiences, those are your fondest memories versus most of VR today has been very isolated experience. And to your point, the in-home experience is always gonna be a bit limited as well as mobile, but you know, to have locations you can go to and go through with a group of people is a much more compelling experience when you're doing it with others.
What about in the field of healthcare, David? I mean, I know that's something that you're super interested in.
So I am right now very focused on digitizing scent, and so in both the context of entertainment and ultimately in the context of health, I have been thinking for many years about healthcare through the air. There's no medium more immersive, obviously, than the air we breathe. And science, since the Nobel Prize in 2004, is finally starting to uncover the secrets of olfaction. As you may know, the only sensory nerve that goes straight to the brain is that of olfaction. So when we smell the croissant, we actually feel it before we cognitively process it. So the best sensory interface we have with the brain is actually through the delivery of scent. And so both from a diagnostic point of view today, there's a big effort in medical science to look at scent and our perception of scent as a diagnostic for not only cognitive degenerative disease, but actually metabolic states. So I actually am more sensitive to the smell of citrus before I eat than after I eat, before I have coffee than after I have coffee. After I'm stressed, my scent sensitivity goes down. And so if you think about scent gaming, if we can deliver scent like we deliver light and sound right now, there's three senses that go through the air: light, sound, scent, and the first two are energy, and the last is mass. So the efforts so far have been pretty bad to digitize scent because we kind of think we can turn the lights on and turn it off, but scent kind of hangs around. So you need to deliver just enough so it behaves like a light particle. But if you can, then suddenly scent gaming becomes a kind of diagnostic. So your ability to get a good score in the morning and then the afternoon is all reflective of how you're doing. So from a healthcare point of view, as you look at the iPhone or Android or whatever it is, becoming a sort of companion to your wellness in the course of your day, the integration of scent signaling suddenly is giving a biological input that sort of superficial, even if it's heart rate, senses are not giving. And that's exciting healthcare, and that excites us. Just to say the final thing here in terms of what we're doing. Nevertheless, we think just like the smartphone has become a really interesting healthcare platform because it was first useful as a smartphone, we're interested in figuring out that consumer behavior that is today something where people will use something like this every day of their lives. And so we're exploring and now in hundreds of homes with a device like this as an accompaniment, kind of like a digital candle in a certain way, that people are using at work and at home and with music.
I think that's a really good explanation of how some of these other senses that you might think of as experiential are actually fundamental just to interacting with the world around you. The fact that you smell something, you actually experience it before you cognitively process it is phenomenal. And there's sort of similar aspects in touch. Just if you have this digital content around you and you want to reach out and pick it up and move it around, actually, because of the location of your eyes on the front of your head, perspective kicks in. And when you get near an object, you can't tell whether you've touched it or whether you haven't using your visuals. Actually, have you picked it up or have you contacted that object is entirely through the sense of touch. And so I think when you sit at the point where you put the headset on and you look around, you can get some amazing VR experiences. But as we're going to actually start, whether it's in training or enterprise or gaming or amazing immersive experiences, you're going to need these other senses probably more than you initially realize just because you don't appreciate what you get from them on the day-to-day basis.
I'm curious about how you do scent, though, with the kind of precision that you need. I mean, when we have tracking on our skin that we've created that tracks down to the sub-millimeter level of precision, just so we know exactly. And we need to be able to deliver tactile sensations. How does one deliver scent in any precise way?
Well, interestingly, firstly, it's a matter of how much scent you put in the air. And so the less scent you put in the air, the more precise you can be. And the nice thing about scent is that it's very, just very trace amounts actually cause. So the closer, you don't want your scent device too far from you because then it becomes pretty diffuse. And that's really where people have made a big mistake. So it needs to be pretty close to you. The second thing, of course, and that you might think from a VR point of view, that's an advantage. It is in a way, although any leakage suddenly is a mess. And so there's a lot of trouble, I think, in managing that. So you need to really handle it with care and just put enough in the air and then have it sort of move away until the next signal comes. Having said that, scent is very much unlike the other senses in that it's more of a secondary signal. So when you have a meal and I have a meal, we both enjoy the meal, but we're kind of not really analyzing how did scent work for you and how did it work for me, although we may both have very clear perceptions of what it looked like. And so scent is more powerful in a sort of unconscious way, and it's a little bit more smeared out, and it can't be true that when I see the chocolate cake, I smell orange, so that's for sure. But the reality is when I have the chocolate cake and I have oranges sitting next to it, I kind of get a bit of a mixing, and it doesn't really bother me so long as I'm not kind of doing a test.
Unless you're doing the molecular gastronomy VR app, and then you can have things not smell like they actually look. I think that's super interesting because, like, we touched a little bit about it, like being, you know, very subtle with some things. We have a tendency to, if your brain to cut out some senses if you're really using, like, focusing with one. So for example, like visuals, right? Like, you can close your eyes and hear a little bit more nuances in music, for example. How do you design around that when you're talking about something that's going to be a full sensory experience? Like, how do you really think about that? Tom, you want to start us off?
I think that in VR, at least as the creators of a VR experience, you have ultimate power over the person's senses as they're experiencing it. So whether that's you actually have the power to shut off certain senses from them in order to highlight something in a particular direction, but also I think part of the reason why when you close your eyes, your other senses come to life a bit more is because you can be very heavily influenced, certainly in touch, by the visuals and what you see. There are some studies of people touching objects where they presented a sort of a virtual display of an object and trying to guess whether what they're feeling is what they're seeing. And generally, they think it is, even if what they're feeling is actually always the same type of object. So you can be really heavily influenced. So I think it's a combination of understanding this control that you have as the orchestrator of the VR experience and augmenting some aspects of the visuals in order to highlight some other senses, or even actually taking bits away.
You really need what you're feeling to agree with what you're seeing. And so, you know, particularly if you're moving the camera in VR, you know, if you were driving in a car and your body wasn't feeling that movement, if the inner ears, the hairs in your inner ear don't agree with that, that's actually when you're going to start to get sick, because your body, that discord is really uncomfortable. And so you really do need those things to be in concert.
I think there's a really interesting playoff between things agreeing exactly as they do in the real life, and then effectively the sensory equivalent of Foley artists for the movies. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you watch a movie and you see somebody walk down a gravel path and you have the real sound of somebody walking down a gravel path, it doesn't sound real. They have to have these exaggerated sound effects so that you believe that you're hearing what you're seeing. And I think you'll see a lot of that in virtual reality as well, where in touch, if it feels really realistic, you won't believe it. It's almost got to feel more. I imagine the same might be true in smell as well.
Yeah, I think it's worth it, thinking about the creation of experiences, not necessarily as being literal sort of translations of what we sort of view that experience to be. I think that it becomes just much more rich, actually, also for the consumer. And so in the same way that an impressionist painting or a surrealistic painting may be capturing reality in just a really different way than our sort of literal experience, particularly with scent, we're interested. So right now, for example, if you play on Spotify or Apple Music your playlist through our Onotes app, it will choose scents that are most emotively connected to that music and therefore amplify the mood of the music. And so it's not really trying to find the orange for the mention of orange, or the dirt for the mention of dirt, but scents that are, again, not really, you're not super conscious of them, but they're emotively persuading you. And so I think that's really exciting, and it's less threatening, I think, from a consumer point of view, and in terms of the competition between reality. I think we're providing whatever it is, however real virtual reality becomes with scent and touch and so forth. I think it's just much more magical if it's a new reality that's opening human experience as opposed to closing it.
I'll add one more thing about haptics and how you design for it, given the fact that your body reacts to one sense or more at a time, but not everything. Someone explained to me the principle of the two-point threshold, where on any part of your skin, there's a distance between two points where you can tell that they're separate, and as they get closer and closer, at some point they merge and your body can't tell that it's two points, it feels like one. And on your fingertips, which are extremely sensitive, that's a tiny distance. And you know, on your thigh, it might be a very wide distance. So, you know, we're designing tactile actuators in different densities on different parts of your body to reflect the fact that some parts of you are very sensitive, some parts are not. And sometimes you're not focused on touch at all. So it's partly product design, it's partly software and content design, and it's partly just testing and figuring it out.
Cliff, I want to hit on you for a bit.
Bring it on.
Hollywood. So, you know, they've been the leaders in entertainment for decades, right? How are they catching up, or are they catching up with kind of what's going on now with these new technologies? Hollywood's always been about storytelling, about, you know, wanting to show emotion, wanting to create emotion in a wide, broad audience. How are they thinking about these new technologies, these new experiential technologies?
Initially with VR, they were viewing it just as a marketing tool, which was, you know, a bit short-sighted. Now you have a lot of filmmakers getting involved and thinking about, you know, what more they can do in this new medium. And we're always talking a lot about storytelling, where in Hollywood, especially when you're creating for film or television, you tend to overwrite. And a lot of our conversations about you can't overwrite for an immersive experience because you have to let the consumer just go explore. I mean, we always say that identify the world you're in, who you are, and your purpose, and then just let them have fun. You know, let the consumer have their own experience, and in some regards, almost tell their own story because they're creating their own memory. So filmmakers are your ultimate control freaks. They want to control everything. In this new medium, you can't control everything. So we're kind of re-educating them, thinking about define the world, create some rules to it, but don't overwrite for it. And they're learning. I mean, you see more and more filmmakers experimenting with it, mostly making mistakes, but they're learning. And the studios obviously love any opportunity where they can take their IP and put it in a whole new medium. So a lot of excitement around it. They're also trying to figure out what's the economics to it. I mean, obviously, at the end of the day, that's what drives them. And VR has been struggling with what are those economic models for consumers, because we all know that consumer adoption is not there yet. So, you know, for things like what, you know, we're doing and Two-Bit, we think it's more about locations, you know, be an attraction. You know, there's a proven model that consumers are willing to, you know, buy a ticket to go to an attraction to have something they couldn't experience at home. And the studios and the filmmakers are all coming around to that.
You know, I was excited to see that Jon Favreau is here today, because if you haven't tried his Gnomes and Goblins experience, it's incredible. Yeah. You know, and to your point, Cliff, about being able to like, go around and explore, it's such a beautiful, elegant, you know, approach to that. You get to do this, and I won't spoil the surprise, but it's really a great, you know, filmmaker approach to VR.
Do you think this could be the rebirth of the movie theater then, kind of to your point, Cliff? Do you think this is something that will bring crowds out again?
I feel like I've been hearing about the death of theaters for 20 years. I get back to what I was saying earlier, the social aspect of it. I mean, I have a, you know, a great 60-inch 4K television at home, but it's not the same as going to a theater. You know, I go to a theater with, you know, my wife or family or friends. Even though I can do a lot of that at home, it's not the same experience. So we do think this is a complement to theaters in that, obviously, the experience that we're creating, some of it is off of big Hollywood IP and complements that theater experience. But also, I think consumers, they want to go into these worlds. You know, we've seen with theme parks, Harry Potter World, and Disney's launching Star Wars World and Avatar World, that consumers not only want to watch these movies and not just play the video games, they want to feel immersed in it. They want to be into it. So we think it's very complementary to whether it's theme parks or movie theaters.
And, you know, Bill Joy has talked for years about the various types of internet. And there's the lean forward internet, right? I'm on the computer and I'm very engaged. And there's the lean back internet, more sort of like your traditional movie, where it's a very passive experience, the mobile internet. He talks about a bunch of others. But I feel like it's important to think about these experiences that way. the lean back, the passive, the I'm going to be entertained, is a different entertainment experience than if you are actively engaged in that thing. And so they really are not mutually exclusive. You know, the immersed, wandering around, full, you know, engaged experience is a wonderful way to experience Star Wars. But then I also want to just be passively entertained also. You know, those are, you can sort of live in that world in multiple ways.
Sure.
And if Hollywood really wants a peek at where, you know, the consumption of VR in public may be going, they should probably look at China, because China has been extremely active for you know, years ahead of the U.S. in terms of bringing people together in public spaces to, you know, to enjoy each other and sort of interactive experiences in VR arcades and internet cafes. And I don't think every lesson is transferable to the U.S., but I think it gives us a peek as right. to where this logically goes.
Oh, that's a good point. You know, something that ties in too, and something I was talking to David about before, is there's obviously a huge psychology to storytelling, but there's also a biology to storytelling, and a lot of, you know, what these technologies that you guys are developing really tie into that. David, do you want to expand that on that a little bit more?
Yeah, I think that the last 20, 30 years have been hugely revealing, as everybody knows, in terms of our understanding of how we process stories, and in storytelling, as we're all describing, there's a sensorial delivery, and that you can control. And then there's this—it's overlaid on the emotive, unconscious mind that has gathered over a lifetime of experience lots of sensorial data, some of which, you know, the touch of a baby's hand or the smell of a woman's skin may be really impregnated in minds. And when the sensorial input is connecting with the memory, it's leading to an incredible emotive response. And so given that most of history has evolved in a very slow way relative to what's happening right now, it was possible to create storytelling rites and forms that belong to societies and times and every once in a while to civilization as a whole. We're in a period where experience is so radically changing that how do you tell a story that actually emotively connects to the current generation, and frankly, will the story connect with me as it does with you, as it does with maybe less and less. And so I think that what you're seeing in experimentation, just listening to this, the last panel and this panel, is both clearly driven by geeks and technology and opportunity, but also, frankly, by consumer need, right? The stories are hugely important. And so from a biology point of view, I think there's a big perfection that's needed in terms of how we deliver these experiences, thought in terms of how do we design them, but also we need to listen and we need to observe how people are reacting, because they have this second part of the story which is in their brains, and we're kind of partners.
Just picking up on the biology track there, one of the things that's always really fascinated me and interested me in the sense of touch is actually that it's really, I think, the only of your senses that you have that you can't temporarily lose. So you can put a blindfold on and find out what it's like to be blind. You can put ear defenders on and find out what it's like to lose your sense of hearing. You can, you know, I'm not sure about taste, but people do lose their sense of taste and smell. That is a condition that happens. But actually, in all of recorded medical history, there's sort of single-digit number of people that have ever lost a sense of touch, but maintain motor control. So the closest you can get is if you fall asleep on your arm and it kind of goes dead, but you compress all the motor nerves as well, so you also can't move your arm, and the movement and sort of tactile properties are kind of two parts of haptic feedback. So if you've never been able to experience not having it, then understanding how much you value that as a sense is very, very difficult to do. And I think that's a really fascinating aspect as we move into virtual reality and we start entering these worlds and trying to sort of, you know, reach your hand out and interact with digital content that's not really there and you can't really feel it. This is almost the first time as a species that we've started running into this issue and finding out how much we value these kind of senses. So
we take a lot of it for granted, right?
Like, yeah.
I mean, it's, you know, especially touch.
I would go out on a limb and say this next revolution after the great information age that everyone's calling the experiential age, which I think is incredibly exciting, it may not reach its potential if we don't figure out the other senses, if we don't figure out touch. Because, you know, as I think Brent was saying before, when you're beyond lean back or even lean in. You're in the world. And you expect the world to react the way it does in real life, IRL. And so that's why we're working so hard on haptics, because we think it kind of doesn't work. Immersion and presence don't really work. I mean, granted, the Void has been very clever about, you know, using physical props to kind of, you know, bring that sense of touch in, but we're trying to recreate it artificially, which we think is a huge opportunity.
I think
I was going to say, when you visit places, whether it's Africa or Amazon, it's not just the visual memory. I mean, I've been to these places where all your senses are on full alert, you know, and we now have the technology that we can recreate those, you know, those sensors that gives you that sense of not only visually seeing and hearing what it's like to be in the Amazon, but to your point, whether it's smell or mist and everything else that has all those senses going, it's going to create more of that immersion and more of the experience that you're trying to tell, whether it's entertainment or education or science, that it's going to, you know, really, it should help everyone. You know, I was reading last week, Elon Musk is going to take people around the moon, you know, and I'm sure it's going to be a handful of billionaires that will get a chance to do that, where the stuff that we're creating really could be for anyone and everyone.
Right, and you're creating a rich experience, right? I mean, again, that's where memory really gets stored. When you have that much data coming in, you're creating a rich experience, that's where that data gets stored in the mind and it becomes real, you know, for a long time. Tom, I'm one of those guys that when I go in the bathroom now and I wave my hand underneath a sink or in front of a towel dispenser and I can't get the towel, I just feel like an idiot. Especially with the technologies that you guys are developing, how are you making sure that you're just creating a better user experience for like virtual knobs and levers? Like, I love the days of real knobs and levers and buttons. Yes. I wish we had more of those back because they just don't work now. How are you making that experience better?
I'm glad you find that frustrating as well. I think one of the major problems with that kind of interface is that it's entirely invisible. You can't see the system that's behind it. It's just, you know, a flat piece of wall. And so when it doesn't work, you have no idea why it's not working. Is it you? Is it the device? Is it broken? And there's no contact point with that technology. And this kind of mirrors over to a lot of people talk about haptics as being this new field that's only started coming up in the last couple of years and has been in a research lab. But in my view, that's completely false. Haptics is actually one of the oldest fields. You know, how a piece of wood feels when you carve it, how textures and material feel, the actual mechanical action of a button clicking, that's all haptic feedback. It's just now we're starting to generate it artificially. So one thing that we're particularly conscious of, particularly in the worlds of virtual reality and augmented reality, is making visible interfaces that when you contact them, you feel them, you get that immediate feedback. Your brain processes touch faster than it does visuals and audio. I think it's 1.7 times faster than visuals. So you pressing a button and the button lighting up, it's so much better and lower intensity on your brain. You don't have to think, is it working or is it not, if you feel the click sensation. And it actually pushes it effectively out of your conscious brain and into your subconscious brain, into this bit of your brain that just processes things automatically and doesn't really consume energy, rather than the lazy part of your brain that's got to work hard. So I think these kind of interfaces where you can't see them, you can't feel them, means you've got to concentrate to work out whether they're functioning or not. We try to do the opposite.
There is no sensory feedback at that point, right?
Eventually water comes out and hits your hand, but you know, 1 in 10.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe.
1 in 10.
Well, I want to give a big shout out to Zvi Greenstein, who was up on the panel before us, because NVIDIA has done the world of VR a big service by creating PhysX and other tools which create realistic physics for virtual objects. And that's something that should be employed by all of us in the VR space to make these things more real. Now, we have to put them to good use, but buttons can feel the way they're supposed to feel. Levers can feel the way they're supposed to feel when they're virtual. and lots more, of course, beyond buttons. But I think it's you know, we have to take advantage of it as an industry, this incredible resource we have in the physical properties of virtual objects.
You want to add some, Cliff?
Yeah, I guess being maybe the old person on the stage, I don't want to lose sight of the craft or the exposition of putting on something, an experience. I remember old days of ILM where we used to build a lot of practical effects and build models and use, whether it was digital or analog, to pull off an experience. And that's one of the things that really attracted me to the Void is we use every trick based on the experience we want to create. And it's not, we use technology, but technology is serving a purpose. And you know, I don't want to lose sight of the art, the craft, and just the showmanship of putting on an entertainment experience and not just rely solely on technology.
Actually, yeah. to riff on that, I think one really fascinating place to look at, you know, for great storytelling is immersive theater producers, because they are, you know, it's not just you're in the audience, but you are wandering around the environment, and good immersive theater productions are going to tantalize all your senses and really, you know, approach that in the way in which we want to approach these immersive VR experiences as well.
Yeah. Right. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, no, if I could just jump in and say I totally agree with that, and I think this notion of generosity when it comes to your public, and as you say, the immersive theater is a really great improv, and I think that we've gone through this period of invention and technology advancement, but now the whole, I think a lot of the story, maybe the whole story, is here with the audience and creating an experience that's just magical, and this then becomes driven by the public, and we're racing after them.
Yeah, to build on that too, I think it's interesting to see where we are now, because I think a lot of times early steps, people tend to sometimes go too far with things. Of course, it depends on the experience. If you're going for something that's a little more over the top, you can do that, right? But for something like subtlety, like you were talking about, David, earlier, I think that's super important for people to keep in mind, because that's what life is about. Life is about subtleties, right? We're not bombarded with all of our senses all the time, because we would just get overloaded and shut down, right? And I think it's so easy for people to think, you know, with these new technologies, to just go overboard with a lot of these, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the bigger challenges. Like, what else are some of the big challenges that you think with exploring these new kinds of technologies?
And I mean, if you're talking about out of home throughput, you know, you can't, you know, if we were a rock band, right, and we wanted to play a concert,
we should totally be a rock band.
Should, yeah, right?
Right? Love that. Right? You've got the pants.
But you know, if we wanted to go from being in this audience to Madison Square Gardens, right, we just need bigger speakers. But if you're going to put more people through VR, you need more equipment, more backpacks, more, you know, staff members to make sure you're comfortable, and so the scaling doesn't right. scale as easily as you know other forms of entertainment.
Here, here.
Yeah, this is a real challenge. Yeah.
What else? So scale, obviously, huge throughput.
I guess to speak from our point of view, I think that scale is good, but a fear here is to because we're talking about scent and it's almost the oldest industry, is that you fall into a niche that belongs to sort of 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 year use of scent. And so to enter into a consumer experience today, which scales to be all that we dream it can be, and doesn't become co-opted into a use pattern that is not really facilitating this. So this issue of generosity and being in a conversation with a 21st century public is the challenge. Yeah.
But I think there's also, we have guys here from amazing experiences that you go out of home and you go and do. There's a lot of VR that's also going to be something that, rather than an 8 or 30 minute experience, will be something that eventually you do continuously for many hours a day. And so designing, from our perspective, the haptic technology to both do the, I mentioned about Foley artists, you know, the whiz-bang, like, blow your socks off experiences in those scenarios. If you're sat at a desk using something all day, every day, you actually want the feedback that you get from all senses to be more refined, more subtle, more gentle, and so from the technology perspective, designing it to do all ends of the spectrum for all of the different markets and applications that VR and AR can go and move into is a challenge as well, I think.
That's something that's super interesting that just popped in the top of my head. What about, and Joe, maybe you can start us off on this one, what about the ergonomics of haptics? Like, is that something that you guys have thought about when you're thinking about haptics technology?
Absolutely. We have biomechanical engineers, and we have people who are thinking about everything from, how to get something as practical as how to get a piece of skin to properly stick to the right part of your body to deliver the haptic sensations, all the way to force feedback and exoskeletons, and can we apply the right kinds of forces to your body that feel real, not don't feel stiff, but let you move the skeleton, and the skeleton can move you. I mean, it's an incredibly complex thing, and that's just to get back for 1 second to the challenge. I would say the biggest challenge for all of us as an industry right now is patience. I feel like we're racing 1,000 miles an hour, toward exciting things, but it does take time for the science to percolate and to develop and to work and testing and refinement. So if the industry can maintain its level of hype and excitement and also be extremely patient, then we're golden.
What do you think our timeline is?
For what?
What do you think the timeline is? Good point. What do you think the timeline is for enterprise mass adoption of enterprise solutions?
Yeah, I think enterprise is ahead of consumer in many ways. Enterprises, because they can save time and money. They're motivated. They're not waiting. This is not Kickstarter. They are. They have a real need for VR and for haptics and for all these senses. And I mean, scent, I've met some fascinating people in the scent for VR industry. They can simulate, rotting flesh and, all kinds of, for training purposes, of course. but burning mechanical oils and all kinds of weird stuff. So they're using it. Enterprise is here today. And I think over the next 24 months, enterprise VR will become more than just an opportunity. It'll become a practice. And that's what we need. That's what we need the whole VR industry to become, is more than just kind of the parlor trick of, oh, that was cool. I want to tell my friend about it, but something that we do repeatedly, we go back to because we enjoy it. So that's a long answer, but quickly.
No, I agree, right? As much as I look forward to the consumer days, I think they're still pretty far off. It's going to be enterprise, light industry, things like that are going to be adopting very soon. And I think we're going to have mass adoption because especially on the haptic side of things, because they're going to be able to save time, save mechanical failures, save people's bodies, right? That's where I'm kind of interested about the ergonomics of that too, because when you're doing repetitive tasks over and over, something like haptics are really interesting to me to think about how that could actually be a little bit less wear and tear on the body.
I would say another big challenge for the industry is bad content. Right? I mean, it's early days. And so if your only experience with VR is something that makes you sick, you might not want to do VR again. And that would be a real tragedy. And so I do think that,
we're still learning a lot about the psychological impact of what we're doing. And just to give a plug to Dr. Adam Ghazali, who will be speaking tomorrow, we've been working with him to really understand brain development and the tools that we use. And I mean, it's one thing for young adults, but also children who are now getting access to this technology and what an impact it has on young developing brains. And there's still a lot of research that needs to be done in this area before it really gets that massive adoption we all think.
Good point. One of the things that you just kind of hit on too, talking about some of the other people in the space, besides your own companies, who do you think is really doing it right? Or who do you think just has a great idea? Or who's kind of really starting out this revolution, right? You want to start, Brent? Or
I was actually really excited about this panel, frankly, because each one of them has done something that I found to be completely awesome.
Absolutely.
So this crew I'm really excited about. Who else is great? Down in Southern California, Servios is making really incredible games. I really love their stuff. I'm going to think about it a little more. Pass it to you guys.
Yeah, I think picking up augmented reality in particular, just to focus on one region, I think the guys that are doing that the best are the guys who are fully reaching for that future vision of not just having visuals overlaid onto your glasses, but actually putting content in the real world and having it be consistent so you can walk away and come back later and it's still there. I think that's that. You know, you have the guys Meta and HoloLens are probably the guys doing the best job there. And you sort of, you try those experiences and you can really just, for me, the first time I tried that, it was a 10-year jump forward in my vision of what this is going to be like and how close we are to it.
Yeah, I mean, for haptics to work, you need all kinds of stuff, all kinds of other pieces of the puzzle. You need motion tracking that's terrific. You need, you know, the game engines to be great. You need, you know, incredible HMDs to go with it. So I give big props to companies like HTC. I love the way they're building the sort of partner ecosystem and the Vive tracker and, you know, and just opening up. I just really appreciate them. You know, I've already given a shout out to the you know, NVIDIA and the physics engines they make. So all the haptics companies that are just out there trying to break stuff and figure out how to, you know, it's kind of 50% hard science, 50% magic trick, you know, so good for all of them to just, you know, keep working through that.
I'm going to give a non-technology answer. I was on a panel with Blake from Tom's Shoes about a year ago, and everyone should know his product, his shoes, but just as important to the whole company is the causes they support. And Blake was telling a story about how when he would launch a new line, he would show a documentary of, you know, the cause he was focused on that year. And everyone who was a sponsor or a buyer would have to support that cause. And over time, most of his buyers would be like, yeah, with the movie, let's see the line, we just want to buy the line. And it was losing the focus of what was most important to him. And then a couple years ago, he started using VR to get people. You know, we always say VR is kind of the empathy machine, but it really got people then supporting his causes more rather than just focusing on his shoe product line. So just as a tool, it was, you know, it was supporting one, his business, but two, his causes, which was, I just thought a great story, and they're doing great work.
So call out, I guess, to Denny Osiello, who stepped down a couple years as the head of medicine at Harvard Medical School and MGH, and was the main consultant behind the Apple Health app and is a main consultant to Google Verily. I think a lot in his perspective on the future of medicine is that we have forever been managing disease to death and are now, just given costs of healthcare and given accessibility of healthcare and all the technology and the barrier between that technology and lives, needing to move to a place where we're managing wellness to life. And that means it's not happening in a hospital, it's not happening in a clinic, it's not overseen by a doctor, but it's sort of happening in everybody's life every day, not because they're saying, well, I need to, as I was saying earlier, improve my immunity. It's like, I want to play a game, or I want to go for a walk, or whatever. And so that thinking is now, it's showing up a bit in kind of an early, in a very imperfect way in the Apple Health app, but in Google Verily is doing amazing work right now, thinking about, well, what will the healthcare and wellness experience be 20 years out, and how do we go from these more entertainment, storytelling experiences to health and wellness management? Because at the end of the day, all of this has got to lead to better lives. And I think that he's at least been incredibly inspirational for me, and I think he's doing some really good work at Google Verily.
Awesome. We only have a couple more minutes left. I wanted to turn it over if there's anything else that anybody wanted to jump in, any thought on somebody's mind instead of asking another question. Wanted to hand it over to our panel. Anybody have anything to add here since we only have about 2 or 3 minutes left?
Well, I think that what's interesting as we move into different senses is the notion that we could actually have a coexistence with other species that is allowing other kinds of communication. You know, we've been in such a rut here for so long, but the idea that actually with touch and with scent, there are possibilities of coexisting with the planet that might be both fun and really good for the planet. So that's a thought.
I would just put in a plug for the VR industry and the sort of multi-sensory side of it to stay diverse and stay inclusive, and it's an incredible start that this industry's gotten. I mean, so many different people from, you know, all races, genders, people working together to make this great. I hope that as we grow as an industry, that we stick with that, because that's the way it should be.
Yeah, I would urge people to create in this space. You know, I mean, it's such an early time, to your point. You know, I mean, and you know, if we were to compare it to sort of the time in filmmaking, you know, we're like in the 1940s, you know, and it took a lot of experimental directors to kind of create what we now call the film industry. And we need that in immersive experiences too. We need a lot of people creating lots of new stuff, because there's so much unexplored territory. So go build stuff.
Yeah, exactly. To your point earlier too, right? Bad content could really ruin everything that's being built up. So create good stuff.
Yeah, please create good stuff. Yeah.
Create good things. All right, I just want to say I am honored to have been up here on this stage with you guys. It's a very diverse group of huge thinkers up here. So thank you so much, panel.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time.